I welcome to the last panel of World Education Summit, and we have esteemed panelists from the PEN India. So I welcome every speaker to the World Education Summit, and here we are going to discuss on the ways to develop educational research on teaching and learning. This is the what's more important regarding the research, how do we have to do the research, what the skills required, and what the most skills required in the teaching and the learning process. So I would like to introduce our esteemed panelists for this session. So I would like to introduce Dr. A. Garg, Director, Kite Group of Institutions, Ghaziabad. Welcome, Dr. Garg sahab. Welcome to the 18th World Education. Thank you for giving your precious time. And I would like to welcome Professor Dr. Rajiv Kumar Adhyay, Director, Hindustan College of Science and Technology from Sarada Group of Institutions, Mathura. Rajiv sahab, bahut bahut dhanyawad sir World Education Summit mein aane ke liye. Thank you for giving your precious time. I would like to welcome Dr. K. Murad, Sailam Institute of Management Studies and Sailam Engineering Colleges, Chennai. Kiran sahab, Murad sahab, bahut bahut dhanyawad aapko World Education Summit aane ke liye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And I would like to welcome Professor SSBN Sharma, Director, College of Engineering, Warangal. Welcome, Sharma sir. Welcome to the World Education Summit. Thank you for giving your precious time to us.
Thank you, sir.
And I would like to welcome Professor Madhulika Kaushik, Pro Vice Chancellor, Usha Martin University from Ranchi. Welcome, Madhulika ma'am. Welcome to the World Education Summit. And this is our showstopper panel. And this panel will be hosted by Mr. Akos Kumar Dubey, the Senior Manager of Philex Techno Media. So here is a wonderful panel we are going to discuss.
Hello.
I said thank you, Ashutosh. Good to be here.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you all the panelists to be here at 18th World Education Summit.
So I request audience to put your questions to the Q&A section, and we will take it live from our speakers. And I handed this session to Ashutosh. Ashutosh, over to you. Thanks.
So thank you all the esteemed panelists to be here on 18th World Education Summit. So we are doing it on 3D platform second time. So first of all, I just wanted to would like to know opening ceremony from all of esteemed speakers, the ways to develop educational research on teaching and learning. So I would like to start with Dr. Vikas Misra, Group Director, Gitanjali Group of Institutions, Udaipur. So I think he hasn't joined. Okay. So now I would like to invite Dr. A. Garg, sir, Director, KIT Group of Institutions.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Am I audible, please? Good evening.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Good evening, all of you, all the panelists here. And I'm thankful to ELTS for inviting me as a panelist on this very, very important topic. Now, I would like to mention that the purpose of the educational research is basically to develop new knowledge about the teaching learning. And the whole idea is to find a new ways to enhance teaching learning pedagogies. That is, to my mind, is the core theme of working on the educational research. Now, having said that, before going deep into the minute details at the grassroots level, I would like to mention that we need to have a change in approach. That is, we need to have to migrate to research-based learning. We are now obsessed with the classroom-based learning, where it is just dissemination of the information,
and it's examination-based learning, basically. Our focus of everybody is, you know, clearance of examination. Now, here I would like to mention that the whole paraphernalia, whole system needs to migrate to what is there in the top universities of the West, where there is more focus towards solving society or industry problems. Like, there is just 25% classroom teaching and 75% students are motivated to solve the industry or the society problem. While here in India, as of now, before the announcement of the national education policy, is the other way around. It's 75% classroom teaching and 25% it is the labs and some kind of projects what we do. Another thing I think we need to work on that is the board of companies. If you see the board of companies in the West, you find in all the board of companies there are professors there, the teaching staff is there, you know, who are taking decisions in the board of companies. And the labs which are there, they all labs are as per the industry requirements, and they are working as the centers of excellence. And all these labs are generating consultancy and patents. Like one of the popular universities in the West, I was reading a few days back that about 30,000 companies have been founded by a particular institution, which is in the top 100 ranking of the QS world. And their alumni, they had the turnover of rupees 140 lakh crores. So that kind of a learning focus is there. So I think the whole effort, what we're going to talk in this session, it should work on a change in approach to a research. Yeah, this is what I would like to submit as my opening remarks. Thank you.
Great input, sir. So now I would like to invite Professor Rajiv Kumar Upadhyay, sir. Sir, what are your views on this topic?
For the invitation.
Yes, sir. Now, again, sir, you are on mute.
Yes, now, yes, sir, now. Is it okay?
Yes, sir, now audible.
So I would like to thank to organizer for the invitation. And I would like to throw some light on education research. As we know that the new education policy has already in a place. So now there is an emergent need to change some teaching methodology. Initially, the traditional teaching was based on a chalk and talk approach. Now we have to change the chalk and talk approach up to some extent by introducing some project way of learning. As rightly said by previous speaker about the project way of learning, patent and these all things. So now the chalk and talk traditional way of teaching, that chalk and talk is an approach by which one can communicate to the student fraternity. But at present we are in an era, how can we transfer our text into reality? If we will inculcate this habit among students, so I think the more outcome-based education can be evolved. In this, at this moment of time, we are in an era of information technology. And we are entering into a strange world in which the rapid change is only with the stable characteristics. So by keeping this view point in our mind, because the student of the today's era, they are more akin towards the social media and internet. So by keeping these all points in our mind, there is a responsibility that is on the head of a shoulder of a teacher. How can we present ourselves as per the requirement of our students and as well as the requirement of the industry? Because the technology is changing very fast, and we have to keep our eyes and ears open to cope up with that technology. And in this for this, the project way of learning, the cutting edge usage of cutting edge technology like additive manufacturing, 3D printing, augmented reality, virtual reality, these all are the cutting edge technology. So we have to give some idea to our students. So that's why we can keep them on the right path, and they can work as per the expectation of the industry. So at the initial level, as a preamble, this is my view, and I will be happy to answer the question if the audience will ask any specific question. Thank you very much.
Sure, sir. Audience definitely will ask the question, sir. So first of all, then I would like to invite Dr. K. Maran, Director Sriram Institute of Management Study. So, sir, please give your inputs on the today's topic. Sir, you are on mute, sir.
And learning experience. Is it audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, now audible.
Thank you very much. Sir, I think today the topic is one of the very, very contemporary topic in the world, education. Education is one of the most powerful tool and weapon to change of our society. If you want to change anything, education is only a solution for the betterment of the society as well as betterment of community. So in this aspect, the education research, even before the education research, the research is based for everything. Even technology based research, satellite based research, economical based research, and any kind of research which is purely based on that education. Suppose the education is failure to do research, how to learn, how to teach, how to framing a curriculum, which is really very, very challenging of all the educators in the world. So in this aspect today, the topic is really very excellent. Education, research for empowering either the individual or the institution or an entire world. So in this aspect today, I have to emphasize the research which is mainly focused on design and structure of learning system. So what is the learning system today? You almost all of you aware of, take for education, even arts and science stream or engineering or any type of education in Indian context, the most of the students preparing only for the corporate. The majority of the students preparing only for the corporate. But what is the really need? We need to preparing as students for the community and society. How to sustaining they themselves? How to respect with others? How to scanning the environment? So such kind of curriculum is very, very important. Apart from the curriculum, the design and structure of a learning system, that's what outcome based education system. Today we are talking about outcome based education system, but what is my observations, the outcome based education, which is not new to in our Indian curriculum, even our Gurukulam school method itself, outcome based education system, even used to call in Tamil Thennai Palli or under the tree education systems. There are n number of traditional education system, our heritage and culture, the learning system, which are highly influenced our ancestor, the old people mind. Because of their learning system, the education system, now we are sustaining in the global markets. Sustaining in the global market, even in take for instance medicines, the scientists, economists, technocrats, over maybe. So today the need of our, the mixed economy, the globalizations, the branding, marketing, there are n number of changing environment. So in this changing aspect, we need to design the curriculum. The structure of learning educational program is one of the most powerful research to change of my teachers as well as my students. Then the teacher's knowledge is very, very important. The teacher's knowledge, how to empower their knowledge in the particular domain. Even as a history teacher or artificial intelligence or the machine learning or robotics or environment, legal, everything, the teacher's knowledge. Then the deepen their understanding about the subjects, about the curriculums. So the kind of research is very, very important. Even today, n number of educational institutions, higher educational institutions doing n number of research. But the way of doing research for the learning, the designing curriculum, implementations. So these are all the lagging today. Only the few institutions which are highly focused. So we need to be more focused, whatever the education streamline. Even engineering educations, we need much more focused teaching learning system. Architecturals, we need much more teaching learning system, the curriculum system. So like this, every disciplines we need to implement the kind of that teachers knowledge, that deepen their understanding. advanced skills as expert practitioners, the skill-based skill matrix, skill-based research is very, very important. The skill-based research in the sense, not only for the teachers, even for the student itself, very, very important. The student skill-based is very, very important. The first standard student, how much they are having their skills, remembering, recognizing, understanding, applications, evaluations, implementations, or executions. So these are the very, very vital part. Very, very vital part. That's what you call here, the skills, expert practices, which are very, very important. Very, very important for the research. So that skill-based are very, very important. Then the teaching learning environment is very, very important. Even the environmental aspect, institutional climate, both for school students or higher educational student, at the same time the teachers. You could see for the past three decades, the research which are showing, you know, the evidence. The private institutional emerging in Indian education system. What about our government education systems? We are talking about IIT, NITs and other Indian Institute of Science and IIMs. What about the second cadre colleges, the government of India spending, Ministry of Higher Education spending billions of dollars. The private sector contributions are very, very high. So you try to understanding the learning environment is very, very important. The learning environment, even the schooling itself, the learning environment. So that kind of study, which is highly useful for our educational systems. In addition to that, the leadership quality, both for the teachers as well as for the students, the leadership qualities. Then you need to interact with the university and school teachers. The educational based universities, take for instance NITDR, National Institute of Technical Teachers Training Institute. Then that institute closely associated with engineering educational faculty. The faculty should closely monitoring the students' performances, as well as the institutions closely associate with monitoring the students' progress, students' skills, students' empowerment. So this kind of collaborative partnerships research are very, very important. Then the schools or colleges or higher education is collaborative with the industries. Unless otherwise, we never sustain anything. So that kind of system also very, very important. Then now the government of India promoting industry institute interactions, industry collaborative research, industry collaborative consultancies. I think earlier we have done it, we practiced it. But where we are lagging, what we are doing, what number of students enroll in higher educations, how many millions of students going for schools, what are the skill-based matrix we have implemented in the schooling system, the college systems, how many of them employable graduates, how many of them having employability skills, how many of them ready for the industries, how many of them ready for the societies. So in different dimensions, we need to analyze only in terms of the research on teaching, learning systems, the curriculums, teaching learnings. So we need to do, even the government of India have to allocate billions of dollars for educational research itself. The educational research, not only for allocation of the engineering or architectures or the medicines or the pharmacy, but we need to be strengthened, we need to be stabilized, the teachers, the learning system, the curriculum systems, the educational system, governance system. So that kind of research which are highly useful for our community. With this, I think this topic is very, very wonderful topic. I'm really appreciating the organizers choosing the right topic for the right time. With this, I can close my remarks. Thank you very much for your great opportunities. Thank you.
And also, sir, it was right inputs as well. So now we have Professor SSVN Sarma, Director, Vagdevi College of Engineering, Warangal. Sir, we need your valuable inputs on this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I am 70. I have completed my 50th year of teaching. In 71, I have started my teaching career. And this is 50, and I'm still teaching daily. I'm taking 2 or 3 classes, being apart from my directorship.
Great.
There is one saying, sir, Kim Jadaha, who is the man with life but equal to a stone. Patatiti na abhyasaha. He reads but never practices. Now, the major problem with our Indian schooling system and college system is students are studying, but they are unable to practice it. And we teachers, majority of us, we think that we are doing our job. We are going for 1 hour. We are throwing something on the students, and students are immediately washing. The modern generation is more smart than our generation. They have many things at their nearest hands. They know the information. They have knowledge. They have inputs. They have internet, everything. But only problem is they are other way engaged. So now what is that a teacher has to do, and how this teacher-students relation must be developed? I have one thing in my mind. A doctor, he has 3 stages to cure a patient. One is pre-stage, that is a diagnosing stage. Second is interactive stage. Third is post-operative stage or post-stage. Now, I hope all faculty and teachers must become like a doctor. And in first stage, most of the time we need to prescribe, we need to allot for diagnosing the student's mentality, student's behavior, student's absorption power. Because of the mushroom growth of colleges, every student from different backgrounds, they are joining the colleges. And there is a vertical split in colleges. I am seeing intelligence, they are prospering. Those students who are coming from villages and other things, they have some problem. We need to, as a teacher, it is our duty. Teacher has to do some research. The research must be, people say that curriculum is nothing but a printed document. But when it is made contest-wise, if the curriculum is applied as per the contest and explained as per the contest, then it becomes a syllabus and a knowledge. For this one, we need maximum tricks. Every day we eat food, but every day we feel that we are eating today only. And every day, kya Hindi mein bolte hai, bahut aswaad, uska aswaad hum dekhta hai. Every day we feel that it is new than yesterday's food. Similarly, a teacher must go to a classroom as if he is entering on that day afresh, and he must be in a position to assess himself, compare himself. It must be a comparison of a teacher with himself. And then he must approach the students. For this one, most of us, our faculty, our fraternity must come together and do research. That because crores of students are coming from the colleges, but are they finding exact positions for which they have studied their courses? Unfortunately, it is not so. I am seeing many MBA graduate, BTech graduate, postgraduates, they are coming and applying for clerical posts, doing manual jobs. There is something, some gap, it is there. That gap we have to fill up. For that one, if this deliberation, today's deliberation, if it can help, I think I would be, and most of us, and all the nation, complete nation will be grateful to us. There is one saying, ko na panditaha, who is not a learned man. Panditam manyaha na panditaha. A person who feels that he has already learned, he knows everything, he is only the man who is not having knowledge in this world. So let us not become in that classified group. And every day, first let's teacher learn and then teach to the student. Every day we must go to a classroom as if we are also students along with students. A student along with student, that type of atmosphere we missed. That means it will instill confidence among the students. This is my opinion. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
Thanks for sir, great inputs. So now I would like to invite Professor Madhulika Kaushik, Pro Vice Chancellor, Usha Martin University, Ranchi. Ma'am, please give your input on the same topic. Ma'am, you are on mute, ma'am. Yeah, now audible. Again, ma'am, it's on mute. Yeah.
Thank you, Ashutosh. As my previous speakers have already said, this is a topic of central interest to all those who are in higher education, and my experience has mostly been in the higher education sector. So what I speak would be sort of resonate more with the higher education sector than any other sector. I would like to say that research is important, not only because it's a factor in many rankings and institutional rating, it's important because it would help your teachers to keep at the cutting edge of competency. So if your teachers are continually to grow and continue to reach their level of potential, then they would need to invest in themselves. And the only way teachers invest in themselves is by creating new knowledge, generating new knowledge, sharing that knowledge with others. And today we live in a world where it is so much easier to have collaborative research models going on. So in a way, while there is so much that is getting difficult in education, some part because of the facilitation of technology, there are certain things which are becoming so much more accessible, and access to partners for research, possibilities of inter-institutional and collaborative research are increasing. That's a good part of it. The second thing that I would like to say is that we need to have continuous research in teaching and learning, because the world of education, especially higher education, has completely changed. We live in a world where we are an information rich and time poor society, and you would observe that teachers used to be the major gatherers and transmitters of knowledge. All that has gone. We live in the post MOOC world, where the best universities allow a large number of very high end courses for free, and they are accessible at any part of the world, with the only requirement that a person has is that he should have the thirst for knowledge and a fairly good speed high internet connection. So access to knowledge is no longer the value that the teacher brings to the class. That therefore the role of the teacher has completely changed, and if I may say so, students today learn, or learners learn, not because of the institutions, but in spite of the institutions, because good knowledge today is ubiquitously available in every part of the world. Therefore, if the nature of teaching, if you're part of an institution and the nature of teaching has changed, the teacher's role is not that of a transmitter of knowledge, not even of an aggregator of law. His role is facilitator and guide, so that he needs to guide his learners as to what are the best sources, where should he go, what are the ways of evaluating sources of knowledge, and how do you integrate all that knowledge. Now that is a big paradigm shift in the role of a teacher, and how do we get to become experts at that? We've become over a period of time good at, you know, getting into the class, teaching, taking a session and so on. But at long last, I'm so happy that at long last we are talking about, in the new education policy, we are talking about outcome-based learning. The last 30 years of my life have been in open and distant learning, and I've been a very ardent votary of technology-based, technology-supported learning, because that opens up so many doors. Now, at long last, we are talking about, not in terms of teaching syllabi, not in terms of lecture hours, but in terms of learning outcomes. And also, we are talking in terms of how to link assessment to learning outcomes. But looking at our own situation, we need to have research in terms of, merely by transitioning to blended learning, using the online platform, you do not really become effective blended learning practitioners. Therefore, we need research in what works, what does not work. What are the components of blended learning that work well? Because we need to relate to what is it that the student responds to? What is it that the learner's expectations are when they come to the class? Please remember, our learners today, and one of the previous speakers said that the learners are far more intelligent, far more not, they have access to knowledge, but do they have the capacity to integrate all that knowledge and put that into the framework of the outcomes, learning outcomes that we have planned for them, or that have been planned for them, or that are expected at a certain level of study? So we need to have our own research models on how do we transition from a classroom-based learning model to a outcome-based learning model, and what are the assessment methodologies we need to apply so that continuously, as the learner is going through the teaching process, teaching learning process, his learning is being assessed. How do we develop dynamic assessment models? How do we do customized learning? My current area of work is application of artificial intelligence in higher education. How can we actually create customized learning tool which can adapt to the slower learner, the learner with certain difficulties, and keep them at a sort of a learning path so that at the outcome stage, they all reach at a sort of an outcome measurable state. The other aspects of research and learning is in every institution, we need to, the topic actually is not really aspects of research. The topic is about how do you develop that research. This research capability, and my own understanding on this university that I'm now associated with, we've been there for three and a half years. Before that I was working in Malaysia, and before that at Vancouver with the Commonwealth of Learning. At a new institution, when you come in and you want to sort of inculcate the research culture, the first thing that you probably may need to do, and this is something that we found useful, is to inculcate a internal research culture, an open culture of finding out, verbalizing your difficulties, and then trying to find solutions for that. That search for solutions is the basic precursor of your desire to research. And therefore, finding your own solutions in terms of, and some of the aspects that we have been worried about is, learners may come to the class, the learners may log into your session, but are they engaged? How do we involve methodologies which can result in great amounts of learner engagement? Again, what are the best pedagogies for this new age learner whose attention span is very, very small? How do we adapt methodologies which will make them contribute in the class, which will make them remain engaged, not only inside the class, but outside the class with the learning problem? So we need a lot of research in pedagogy and evolving pedagogies. My last comment as far as these opening comments are concerned is, when we look at evolving pedagogies and methodologies and so on, we also need to be very conscious of the environment, in the sense that we live in a VUCA world. We also live in a world where the requirements of the industry and the employer groups are changing so fast that sometimes we feel we are training students for a world which hasn't come into existence as yet. So some of those learning competencies, and how do we constantly adapt? So learning agility for the teachers themselves. How do we quickly learn? How do we quickly adapt? And how do we transform a learner into a lifelong learner? So this learning agility that has to be inculcated not only among learners, but among the teachers, as somebody who works with them as a teaching learning team, is something that is a matter for research. And this is highly contextualized. So we need to look at our own learners, our own situations, and develop our own models. And for that, action research is a very vital link. I would like to stop here and maybe listen to others and then come to the closing remark. Thank you very much.
Nice thought, ma'am. Definitely, it's very fruitful. And now, again, I'm inviting Dr. A. Garg, sir. And sir, according to you, why educational research on training is very important for domain?
and how educational research can help in improvement of education.
Okay. Once again, and I would like to thank all the eminent panelists for giving so much of input, and I would like to just connect few dots. Now, coming back to my previous point about why we need to go for the educational research, is very, very important topic. I think this is what matters, and this is the last mile connectivity in the classrooms and the design of the entire academic culture in any institution. Now, how to implement it? You know, that is the question. How to do that? You know, the ways to develop educational research. Now, to my mind, that the only way to work on the educational research is just to work on the outcome-based education in letter and spirit, and thereby focusing on the improved graduate attributes, what has been laid out by AICT. Now, that is what only we need to do. How we need to do, that is extremely, extremely important. If we could link our education system in the classroom to the outcome, with a clearly defined outcome, what do we want? As I mentioned, we need to have a more focus towards solving society or industry problem. If we could probably aim all our teaching to this kind of a outcome in various degrees, I think the whole objective is achieved. Now, how we can do it, that is where the research lies, you know, the interest of the research lies. And there are so many tools which are available. Now, coming back to the outcome-based education, I would like to draw the attention of all the audience here and all the eminent panelists, that there are three kinds of domains of learning, as we all of us are aware. One is the cognitive, the second one is affective domain, and the psychomotor domain. Now, cognitive domain is the one what we focus. You know, in our accreditations, in our NBA accreditations and all, and the whole thing is working on the cognitive domains. Affective domain and psychomotric domain, we are yet to work on them. You know, affective domain is the kind of feelings and emotions, and psychomotric domain, how much are you moving? Like there is a lab, in that lab, how much are you moving? There is a movement, physical movement for the students in the classroom. So that kind of a domain, if you are able to work on all these three domains, for the outcome-based education, then I think it's a very, very important step. Now, there are ways and means, like I would like to mention, I mean, it may not be applicable to all the institutions, but majority of the institutions have implemented the outcome-based education. But then I think it is only a mechanical process which has been implemented. Now, learning the outcomes, how to define the course outcomes, how to define the program, I mean, which is already laid, how to have that kind of a mapping with the POs, and how to find the gaps, and what to do with the gaps. Now, all those things are still, to my mind, at the infancy stage in large number of institutions. If we could do some focused work in this direction, I think that would be a very, very important step. And if you see, the NBA guidelines also are not very, very clear on that. No, they have given the entire blanket on this entire thing, that you have to do it. Now, how you have to do it, that has to be found out by all the education institutions themselves. Now, this is one very important thing. Now, one of the tools, to my mind, as one of the speakers brought out earlier, about implementing project-based learning or the problem-based learning. Now, this can be one of the tools to implement outcome-based education. Now, the whole idea is, as my previous speaker, as I mentioned about making the classes interesting. Now, how do we do it? Now, we are talking of the Bloom's taxonomy levels from 1 to 6, but we are mostly working in the classrooms only on the taxonomy level 1 and 2. We are hardly applying, asking the students to apply anything which is not being developed in the classroom. That kind of a culture, probably through the project-based learning, is the need of the hour. Once we do that, once our teachers get prepared to implement that, to understand how to convert the normal curriculum of the university using the PBL tools, how to find out the small little projects for these problems in the classroom, then there is going to be a true learning. And that is where the blended learning is going to be very, very useful. Now, I would like to mention that today, we are sitting here in online mode. Probably 1 year back, we would not have thought of sitting in a online mode, because all of us have gone used to working in a blended mode, in an online mode. Now, to my mind, the COVID has done more good to the education sector than harm. I mean, it may be true for the education sector. The large number of sectors probably
there's a lot of harm which has been done by the COVID. But as far as the education sector is concerned, I think all of us have learned to go in a blended mode. And this is my another point, that now the time has come where whatever learnings we have accrued in last 1 year, about the blended learning, about the online learning, that should continue in the new phase. And we must go for a blended learning. And the project-based learning could be one of the options. And we can use a lot of tools which are available free online, where the institutions have got the LMS and they have got the ERP, they can be used. And this can be a regular mode of dissemination of information to all the students. Now here, having said this about the outcome-based education and one of the techniques as the PBL, project-based learning. Now, what I feel is that we need to customize the learning for each student. Now, here I would like to mention, like our glorious past also, Guru Dronacharya, the Eklavya, the famous the student of Eklavya, who learned how to use Tir command. Now, in that, he learned all this technique using the virtual learning that time. And the Pandavas, Guru Dronacharya, he understood the importance that there is a need to give a personalized training to each of the individual. Thereby, we can see that all the five Pandavas, they have got a different attributes. So that is the need of the hour, that we need to personalize the learning path for each and every student. Because one size cannot fit all. And that is where the technology today can be of use to everybody. Like the artificial intelligence as a tool, it can definitely address this kind of a requirement. Because each student has got a different learning capabilities. He's got a different interest. He's got a different personality attributes. And therefore, with these tools, we can have a personalized learning path developed. And that is where the importance of a research in the teaching learning is extremely, extremely important and critical. Now, another thing is that, as has been brought out by one of the speakers, that is not only the technical education. There is the importance of the soft skills. Now, there is the importance of humanities and liberal arts to learn the impact on human behavior. What technology we are asking the students to develop. How is that technology going to impact the humanities? What is going to be the reaction of the human behavior on that? That also probably needs to be given to our students. And that is what, again, can be given as a part of the research. And probably also what course outcomes we are designing, those course outcomes also can have these components integrated into it once we are making the course questions. In the course outcome, once we are defining the course outcome, these kind of questions can be put into that also. So that will take time, slowly. But then there are a lot of areas for research in this particular direction. So to my mind, I would like to reiterate, if we are able to implement outcome-based education, we are going to have a effective teaching learning for all our students. Now, before I conclude, I would like to mention two more points. First is that all the institutions are, thanks to this particular crisis again, which I mentioned, it has done a lot of good to us. Now, most of our institutions now in the higher education sector, they have got a learning management system. It may not have been there earlier, but now everybody has got it. There is the effective ERP also. Now, what we need to do is that in addition to this, we need to personalize the learning using artificial intelligence tools. Now, if this thing is done, probably we are going to move ahead in a very fast manner. But then there are integral challenges also. Now, once I am saying that use the technology, you personalize the learning path, but then there are a lot of problems in terms of the data secrecy. Now, once you have everything onto the cloud, which consists of the personality attributes, the learning capability, the kind of strengths and weaknesses of the students, it becomes a very challenging task for everybody, because that also is a threat. We need to handle the data very, very carefully. So that those are the challenges which are associated with the implementation of all the technology that I'm sure we are going to find a way forward in future. So these would be my thoughts. And I think it's a very, very important topic which all of us are discussing today. And because the last mile connectivity, the classroom connectivity, if you could improve for the students about the research we can talk. If we improve the teaching learning in the classroom, definitely is going to give rise to some problems which the industry is facing or the society is facing, which can lead to more publications. You know, student can be motivated to go for the publication. Maybe the project, finally the projects what we are talking, those projects can have a clear-cut outcome of going for a publication or maybe some patent. Maybe we have some patents or publications in the 4 years of journey of the student, then definitely we are going to talk of a good research environment. And what West has got, that you are solving the society problem or the industry problem, probably our education students, our education journey also will somewhere focus on these issues. And also, if you are able to do this, then why not allow some of our students, maybe 10% of the students or maybe less, they would be motivated and they would find a gap for an entrepreneurship journey. Probably some business model can be developed. And maybe in the times to come, we can have students who would become job givers rather than job seekers. And that can happen very well once they are within the institutions only. So I think the whole problem and whole issue can be addressed by having a proper educational research on teaching learning and very, very effectively implementing in our own institutions in a various capacity in different time frame. But this is what needs to be done. Yeah, these would be my thoughts. I think over back to you for other panelists to share their views. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So now I come to Rajiv, sir. Rajiv sir, same question I am putting you. Why how educational research can help in the development of education, sir?
Question is, I would like to answer in this way because some senior panelists are also there. So I would like to prefer more to listen to them. So in a crux or in a nutshell, I would like to say one point here. The education can change the face of any nation. And basically, as my this previous speaker explained about the project way of learning, customized learning, these are the things which should be always should also be emphasized. But basically, the mindset of student and the even the mindset of the parents are always towards the employment of the student. So they are in first year itself, in the very beginning of their study, they are more worried about the placement. So now we have to seek how can we change this mindset of the student or even their parents also. Basically, as far as my this part is concerned, so I am more this efficient this of view that there are some grassroots element. If we will inculcate these grassroots element in the students during the 4 year stay in their campus, then I think their employment potential will automatically enhanced. But without knowing these grassroots element and we will think only about the employment, I think at the end of the day they will be away from that. So as far as my part is concerned, I am a strong believer that we have to this first tell to our student can now how they can use the available in physical and organizational infrastructure which they have, because we feel that the student are more concentrated about their department, what are the other facilities which are available in the college. If they will avail these our facility, they can inculcate the rest of the behavioral skill, managerial skill and other things also. The second grassroots element that should be inculcated in the student personality from the first year or second year, that is the foundation course, means that their foundation course should be strong. So how can we make our teaching methodology by which their foundation courses, some extra care should be there. Number third is that they should be inculcate quality among their personality, that is the socio-cultural aspect. Suppose they are pursuing their BTEC degree program from UP and some other student are pursuing from the Andhra. So now they must know what are the socio-cultural aspects if they will learn something new about the social cultural aspect, it will reinforce their capability to project way of learning. And personality traits and attributes, we should inculcate we should tell them that these are the minimum set of personality traits and attributes. During your 4 year of stay, you must inculcate these personality traits and attributes. There are certain professional and academic skills also. So we should tell them at the very beginning that these are the set of professional and academic skill. If we will tell them about these 5 or 6 quality grassroots element, I think the employment potential will come automatically in their personality. In the changing time, the role of a teacher is to create the interest among the student, and a teacher should know what are the strength of their student, what are the weakness of their student, what are the opportunity for them, and what are the threat for them. If as a teacher, I know for the particular student, these are the strength of this, these are the weaknesses, these are the opportunity, and these are the threat, I can guide him or her accordingly. So by these view, I would like to say at the last, now the role of a teacher is vital in the present time. If a teacher is more close to the student, then the customized teaching can be evolved, and the customized teaching can work for an overall development of a student. Thank you very much.
Correct, sir. Nice, nicely, sir. Correct, sir. So now my next question is for two esteemed speakers. How it can help it curriculum development and improve teaching approaches? So, and I would like to answer from two speakers, Dr. K. Maran sir and Dr. S.S. V.M. Sarma sir. So start with Dr. K. Maran sir. Sir, you are on mute sir. Yeah, now. Sir, Vaz is not coming, sir. Not audible, sir. I think some technical issue.
Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, what is your question? Can you please
repeat sir, it? My question was how it can help it in curriculum development and improve teaching approaches.
Yeah, please. Thank you very much. You might be thinking that I'm a senior man and I'm still thinking in an old fashion. I'm not thinking in an old fashion. I'm still a learner. I'm teaching the perfect modern skills. At this juncture, I'm a specialist in machine learning, data science, and artificial intelligence. My research topics, I have PhD students also. Now, my main thrust regarding students, the students who are joining colleges, their only goal is to get a job. So goal is fixed. Everywhere goal is fixed. But only the problem is path is not fixed. What path they have to lay down to reach their goal, and how curriculum fits into it. This is the problem which most of the colleges, most of the faculty, most of the academicians are facing. I think Mr. Maran is still speaking. I think you have to. I'm sorry. Hello?
Hello? Sir, please go ahead, sir. My technical team will connect you. Maran, sir. Maran, sir, your voice is not coming. My technical team will connect you.
Yeah, I will. So now.
Meanwhile, yeah, sir, please go ahead.
My observation is every student, he is not research oriented, but job oriented. Yes. It is true. The job is very important. As our previous speaker has given us an input, that most of the parents, when they come to our technical colleges, they will ask only one, sir, do we get placements? Now the curriculum and the placement, both are not connected to a student of electrical engineering. He may go to software, a software man may go to any other discipline. So these are all some problems which are there, which are existing in higher education. The only thing is the turn up towards research oriented and higher learning is very low. Majority of the students who cannot get placement are some of the students who are really interested. They may pursue higher education. And after higher education, how many of them are going towards research? This is the problem. This is the main problem. Now, our nation's main problem is students, most of our faculty are students. They are not research oriented, but they are only oriented themselves towards jobs. This is one aspect which this 21st century and particularly the modern age has seen. Now, the curriculum, whenever a curriculum is being made, are we doing the curriculum in the present context or not? This is most important, as I have earlier said. The research-oriented topics, which are at even undergraduate level, are not being pursued seriously by the students. Now, here lies major role of teachers, faculty. I would like to bring one point to all the esteemed audience here. AICTE and UGC has declared that PhD is a must. So research is must for a faculty and it is goal. I am sorry, most of you know that goal is fixed, but the path is not. We do not know how many researchers who are coming out of institutions with their doctorates, they are genuine. So the curriculum part has to be strengthened and these measures, stringent measures have to be introduced at the higher level and at the lower level also. For this one, the major role must be played by a faculty man, by a teacher. A teacher, when he goes to a class or when he approaches students, a group of students, do we have some time to spare to students explaining about the life's ambition regarding the higher education and research-oriented education? Are we spending? We are all burdened with morning 9:30 to 4 o'clock regarding our what is called customized teaching learning process. Are we spending any time with the students? I'm asking a question, how many of our faculty have adopted the students? I'm talking here on this platform with confidence. I have adopted. Every year I am adopting 10 to 20 students. And I spare my time to them after working hours. The outcome may not be so much positive, but there is a small trial by me. I am doing it. In most of the institutions, the major burden falls on faculty, and faculty, how they mold the curriculum. Curriculum is not, it should not be taken for granted that a university has prescribed a curriculum and they have prescribed a syllabus, and this syllabus has to be completed in a semester or in a year. The curriculum must be eye-opener. The curriculum must be practical-oriented. Curriculum must be explained with real-time examples. For this, a faculty has to do a lot of homework. This homework, it needs not time. It needs not effort. It needs confidence. It needs devotion to this profession. Now, there is a vertical split with metro cities and cities like our Warangal and other places. They are all rural based. Most of these students, they come to our institutions without knowing what higher education is. I hope 70% of the students' population in India are in this category. 30% are in metropolitan cities. And all of them, they join, as our previous speaker has told us, their neighbor would have encouraged them, their parent would have encouraged them, or their earlier faculty would have encouraged them. They just join. And the major challenge with all our faculty lies in molding that 70%. Molding 30% is not a problem, because already they are molded. They are in a good society. They are coming from a cross section. They have their goals, and with their goals they are approaching. But however, this rural India, because my entire service has gone through rural India, and I'm finding this innocence among the institutions. People are worried about their research degrees because they don't get their increments or they don't get employment. And for that one, I'm sorry, some of them are genuine, some of them are not genuine. Government should not lay emphasis on this aspect. Because they have emphasized that research is a must for a faculty, they are going in a wrong way, some of them, not all. I am not blaming all. In that way, our goal-based learning is distracted. Now here, if all of us feel that every student is a light of our nation, we will never see that the switch is off. We will always see a continuous current passes through these knowledgeable students. For that one, curriculum, sir, as you have given, the panelists are talking, curriculum is wonderfully fixed. The curriculum in all our universities, I go through all of the universities' curriculum. Really, it's wonderful. I don't see, I can compare with Western countries, USA. I had been to those countries and I have seen their curriculum. Our curriculum is more loaded. Our curriculum is good. Implementation part is a little bit, it has lost its path. Practical oriented curriculum, context oriented curriculum, curriculum is there, but its essence has to be drawn. And in that direction, every one of us has to do research. I'm sorry to say that whenever a rural student is approached, he does not know what research is, what other things is. He is bothered whether he gets 60% or not. He is bothered about his earning. He is not bothered about his higher education. I'm seeing such rural India, rural population. The curriculum which has been evolved in our complete university level, it is not second to any other curriculum, but it is lacking some aspect. That aspect is, it is not laying proper path to the goal. Here goal is fixed, initial state is fixed, only thing is shortcuts are being used by most of them. Shortcuts always leads to wrong results. Outcome-based education must be in such a way that the path laid to reach the goal must always be a strong path and a righteous path. In that direction, if all panelists can suggest to the nation how this path has to be laid. Curriculum is there. It is 100% it is laid down. Curriculum is wonderful. If I ask you a question, suppose in machine learning or in any electrical engineering, design of machines or any hydraulics or anything, if you take the syllabus books of any university, all the books are world standard books. the syllabus is wonderfully crafted, at very that we are not getting proper crop. We are sowing the seeds, but the seeds are not getting up from the earth. I'm not having any pessimistic way. I'm a relentless fighter. I want that till my death, I would like to examine this question. For this one, are we encouraging the students to question us? Questioning is a most important, salient future of research. How many classes are in a question answer session? I'm finding in most of the colleges, there are no questions from the students. The teacher just explains and goes. And the student never questions. Are we encouraging the students to question? If there is no question and there is no answering and there is no problem solving and no understanding of the problem, all these deliberations will go waste. The deliberations must be to cure the original disease. We are curing the peripheral diseases. In that way, if our deliberations, if they can help the elite people, I think we will all be always grateful. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Manasir, can you summarize this topic in 2 minutes?
Yes. Sorry for the interference. I think there are some technical issues. Yeah, I think obviously the curriculum is a base for everything. Today, why almost all university, higher education, AICT, UGC, everyone worried about the syllabus? Why? Because the curriculum, without curriculum, the teachers will not enrich the students' part. Take for instance, I have told you, mathematics. Earlier, the mathematics learning system something different. Today, the mathematics learning system something different. Today's students are bahati. I think the execution part something different. Why? Almost all people here, those who are affordable, now they are putting their children to learn abacus. Here, what methodologies we have followed? We have produced the n number of scientists in the world with the mathematics, software engineers with the mathematics. So now, nowadays, the need of ours to change the curriculum. Take for instance, National University of Singapore, some foreign universities. Their curriculum systems, what when you are producing any engineers, there are three-way path methods they are following. Any developed countries or top 100 QS ranking universities. There are triple pathway method, even the curriculum itself, they are built up. The first path, the student should be a professional engineer for the corporate. The students, only the professional engineers, we mold them to be a professional engineers. But what we are doing for the past 3 decades, 4 decades in engineering education, as well as the other educations, we are preparing students only for the corporate. So they are 100% preparing professional students. The second part, what they are doing, they are preparing for the innovations and incubation, then the techno entrepreneur. Today now we are slightly revising the syllabus in entrepreneurships. The entrepreneurship is only for engineers, I never accept. Entrepreneurship only for commerce, I never accept. Entrepreneurship is every student would learn. Even the botany students would learn how to do the cash crops product or plant science or whatever the product they are making. Even the zoology students can do how to market their aquaculture or some other prawn cultures and some other development areas. Even the art and craft students can improve their skills in entrepreneurship. Today, the government of India for the past 1 decade insisting about the entrepreneurship internship policy. So that's what the curriculum, this is the need of our to change the curriculums. So that universities work for the past 50 years, they have inculcated all the students, whether you want to be a professional engineers or technocrats, technopreneur, innovations. So this is another one part. Then the third part is a professional scientist. Today, we are talking about education, higher education's qualities. I am also part of India. I am real patriotic. I am real Indians. I am a literate peoples. I can agree. At the same time, the world statistics, what they are reflecting, you know, the last year, the patent obtained country all over the world, the China is number one country. The second, US has got it. Third, the German. Fourth, Japan. Then Korea. Where is our Indian education system? That's what the education systems we are slightly changing today. Earlier, the curriculum systems what insisted something. But today, the curriculum systems what we need to revise the curriculums to what? Fulfill the entire nation needs or the people needs. So not only for engineering educations, one is the consultant or the research professional or the entrepreneurs. So these three parts are very, very important. So like that, we need to encourage our students in other domains, other disciplines, other disciplines. Even in India, I observed only two type of programs which are highly application oriented. One is the architectures and another one is the medical students. The rest of the students, what they are doing, I think we are producing n number of engineers, the largest number of engineers for the country. But how many of them having employability skills? So this is the need of our to redefine the design of the curriculum. So the curriculum is based. So almost all private universities, very excellent universities, private colleges, autonomous institutions, they are preparing very excellent syllabus. So without syllabus, without syllabi, we can't do anything. So the curriculum is based. The curriculum is based. At the same time, as a teacher, we need to teach how to teach based on that curriculums. Even my observations, my perceptions, without curriculums, I can able to teach my students. So that kind of skills very, very important. But we need to train. That's what I'm saying. The teacher's research is very, very important. The teacher's learning research is very, very important. Up to 5 years of experience teaches what kind of knowledge they have, what kind of learning capabilities or the teaching capabilities or the motivating of my students, molding of the students, mentoring of the students. The 10 years of experience teaches what level of knowledge they have, what kind of experience they have. So we need to research on our teachers' skill, their capabilities. So that's why the quality of the teachers also very, very important. Where we are diluting, the stakeholders are very, very important. Even the policy maker, the educational institution, but have to connect with the policy maker. The researcher has to connect with the policy maker. Our policy maker has to connect with the researcher. So here you need the stakeholders' cooperations are very, very important for betterment of the entire education system. Curriculum is basic. Without curriculums, we can't do anything. So with this, my grateful thank, I think due to my technical issues, you have given some of opportunities to share it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Before closing remarks, I just come to Madhulika, ma'am. How to bring cognitive learning in higher education, ma'am, according to you? Ma'am, please, we need a quick response on this. You are on mute, ma'am.
Yes, I need to have a very, very quick response because there is hardly any time left for me to speak. I'm sorry, but the time management in this session hasn't been very good. Let me very quickly come to this. Professor Garg had very initially, when he was talking about different domains of learning, talked about cognitive capabilities or cognitive abilities in teaching and so on. Now, in terms of cognitive skills, which is basically knowledge-based transmission, collection, acquisition of knowledge, and delivery of that knowledge, this is a model that we've been following for a long time. When we talk about outcome-based learning, actually we need to define our outcomes in terms of cognitive, affective, psychomotor, and so on, and therefore look at the outcomes in terms of measurable, demonstrable, something that can be assessed, and so on. And Professor Garg, when he was talking about that if we adopt outcome-based learning, actually we can solve a lot of problems. Professor Garg, my problem and my experience in the last 2 years has been that while it is good, it's fashionable to talk about outcome-based learning, it's also a sad fact that a very large percentage of teachers in our fairly developed institutions do not really know how to define learning outcomes. What is also not known is how to link your assessment into learning outcomes. The last whole year, in fact, I must have conducted at least 18 workshops in various parts, right from Maharashtra-based institutions to Indira Gandhi National Open University to wherever, where we try to explain, I mean, try to sort of inculcate the differentiation between outcomes and objectives, outcomes and the need to link assessment with outcomes. So the problem is only evolving in the sense we need to therefore train ourselves. Part of research, not only in cognitive learning and within cognitive learning, how do we actually, what are the kind of cognitive skills we are looking at and how do we relate outcomes to those cognitions and how do we actually create our assessment to measure? I mean, I've been a management teacher all my life. A standard way of doing your management assessment is you develop a certain set of application-based questions relating to practice and so on. And then you have a case study which sort of integrates their knowledge. But have we tried to really say how many of my learning outcomes are actually being measured in this term and assessment? What have I already measured in my continuous assessment? Now, those things have to be brought into practice. And that is where the role of research would come. I'm sorry, there is hardly any time left and I would not be guilty of transacting my time. We may need actually more opportunities to talk about some of these things. Designing of outcomes at the course level and at the program level are two very different skills and takes time. I'm very happy to report to you that at the Usha Martin University, every faculty right from 2018 has had to, I mean, at the beginning of each semester, they have to submit their course file where they have to define course learning outcomes and the assessment process and so on. And a lot of my time goes in actually going back and correcting those because some of them are not really outcome based. So all of those issues go on, but this is a practice that has to be inculcated. We have not answered one question throughout this session, which was important. How do we actually inculcate the research culture in universities, in teaching and learning? People do disciplined research because that is a requirement of their promotion and so on. But in active teaching and learning, how do we inculcate? How do we incorporate that culture? Maybe Ashutosh would need another workshop for this or another conference for this. But next now is not the time. Yeah, I will stop here.
We are in some more time for this topic.
Yes.
So great inputs from all of you. Now
I was talking about that. How much research the faculty has to do in understanding the students, in understanding the mood of the students, and then talking to the students. That is the basis of this, madam. I think I have touched that point.
Yeah.
Sorry for interruption.
So not an issue, sir. Now I need closing remarks from all of you. So let's start with A. Garg, sir.
Yeah, thank you once again. Yeah, I would like to quickly say that like if you see a country, there are about 51,000 universities and colleges and they fall in various tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 India also. Large percentage, about 430 universities which are there in the rural area. Now, my only closing remark would be a appeal to the EdTech companies. The large number of education technology companies are there. Now, we have talked about outcome-based education. I was trying to touch upon the artificial intelligence. Maybe EdTech companies can work on making the job simpler. As Professor Madhulika mentioned, that it's really not reached the grassroots levels, the outcome-based education. Maybe at various levels, you know, varied levels for all these different tier, you know, colleges, there needs to be a good understanding. And in case some kind of a software, you know, could help in that. That is one. Second, my request is there's a lot of confusion which is there, a lot of pressure, rather, I'll say. One is the curriculum, and then we want to make our students industry ready. You know, and we hear that, you know, the student should do this course, that course, and so much of confusion is there. Student is also kind of confused. So in case we can define a learning path, in case we can design a software where the curriculum of the university can be put into that software, the interest level of the student, suppose a computer science engineering student, he wants to do a specialization in artificial intelligence, there can be a mapping and the kind of a difference in the curriculum and the interest level of the student that can come out. And all the projects and the internship which are required to be done in the curriculum, that should be done in the interest areas of the students, which will avoid the duplicacy. Finally, it leads to the placements. So this kind of a, some kind of a software with the tech companies, I think that would be a good idea. And it would ease a lot of pressure on everybody, on the educational institutions, as well on the students. So thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here in the amongst the eminent panelists. And thank you, ELTS, for giving me the opportunity to present my views on this forum. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Professor Raju, sir, your quick remarks on this. Sir, you are on mute, sir. Sir, please unmute your mic.
Yes, am I audible?
Yeah.
So thank you very much. And I would like to throw some light on as my closing remark on that. I think the education, new education policy will answer the certain question which we have in our mind. So the time in a year or two, we will find a solution of the various question which we have in our mind. And basically at the closing remark at the last, I would like to bring one point here. Okay, now we have to shifted ourselves from chalk and talk to the project way of learning. The project way of learning is the only way by which we can motivate our students in a, as per their interest. So thank you very much.
Welcome, sir. K. Maran, sir, quick response from your side.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I think my closing remarks, in our education system, it should be interdisciplinary oriented education system. Nowadays we are introducing, we always encouraging, but still it is not up to the mark. Why I am saying, the English literature students pursuing only the pure English oriented language courses in his program. He doesn't know about computer, he is not allowing to learning the computers. But the guy would learning the computer knowledge, then the students would be able to become a consultant or a entrepreneur in terms of content writer, web design development, or the journalist, or freelance journalist, or he can start his own journal something. So like that, many disciplines, the most of the disciplines still, which is not interdisciplinary oriented. Even the engineering education systems, so what we are doing here, your robotics is one of the base, but how many have been doing robotics here? The private universities, now they are enjoying, now they are framing very excellent universities, where in this case of affiliated colleges, some of the universities, they are not. Now, nowadays, the AICT, insisting open university, open elective courses, professional elective courses, choice-based credit system. So these are all really what more useful for the students. But still, there are many universities, many colleges, rural-based colleges, even students not able to aware of is career enrichment, career knowledge, career opportunities. So for all these things, teachers only a role model. Even the curriculum is on par with the standard, but teachers should be a standard. If teachers think something, he can change anything. The teachers based on research, is very, very important. What we are doing, even the engineering based research, how many of them really conducting our experiment oriented research, the teaching and learning and the curriculum based engineering education systems in India? The competency of my engineering students, the employability skills of my engineering students, they are more and more focused only technology, technology, technologies. They never allow to talk about sociology, psychology, anthropology, entrepreneurology, and something, something. Even 20 years back, 30 years back, the same engineering curriculum was introduced. Psychology, industrial psychology. Nowadays, the curriculum totally restricted. Why? Because everything is automation. Suppose the engineers should be more and more focused on technologies, the engineers only for the engineers. But when the gentleman will become a social-oriented engineers, society-oriented engineers, when the gentleman has to fulfill these social needs, that's what you try to encourage our students to find out the social issues, social-based issues. That issue should be sorted by my engineers, my students, my students. That kind of curriculum always enrich my society, fulfill my rural India. With this, my grateful thanks for your great opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I come to Professor S.S.V.N. Sarma. Sir, please give your closing remarks in 1 minute, sir, if possible.
Sir, thank you. Sir, my final remark is every person has his family life. Every person. As a teacher, as a faculty also, we have family life. We love our family, we love our children. Now, we have to demarcate our life in such a way that the students must be loved by us just like our family, and our involvement, our faculty involvement must be there. They must segregate their personal life and the teaching life. A teacher comes, whenever he approaches management, he talks about his personal life, he talks about his emoluments and other things. Yes, he has every right to talk it, but his involvement with the student, just like his involvement with his family, I think this will solve the problem to a larger extent. And involving himself in developing the curriculum, in imparting the curriculum, and making it practical oriented to the students, I think that satisfaction, I don't think even we will get in our own family. Let us try in that direction. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Madhulika ma'am, what is your closing remarks on this?
My closing remark would be more about the research culture within universities and how do we actually begin to inculcate that. Now, if we are talking only about teaching learning, each institution, it is our duty as a university, as an institution, to have a formalized research policy in place within which we need to have a space for what is the research that we would like to dedicate, what are research priorities in terms of research on teaching, learning, assessment, effectiveness, and research on learner engagement. How do we actually involve the learners into becoming active participants in the teaching learning process? As long as they are just sitting, listening, and not really having the spirit of inquiry and questioning, they would not be active learners. So active learning is something that we need to inculcate. A good curriculum is good in the sense, I mean, it's not a piece of paper that has to be put through the board of studies. It has to be activated. And when we activated all of these active learning, project-based learning are all components and valid components, so long as they activate the learner's mind into a active learning phase. And when we're talking about learning outcomes, kind of research in terms of how many outcomes were actually, which were the components which made the greatest contribution to learning outcome. So for example, if you're using a MOOC-based course, if you're using an open education resource, does it have any contribution towards the cognitive learning outcome? And so now these are areas of research that we need to adopt and need to verbalize them so that the teachers have a very clear direction as to while they do their discipline-based research, what are the other components of research that the institution would be valuing? I think as an institution, we have the duty of verbalizing and sort of formalizing our research agenda and research priorities dedicated to teaching and learning. I'd like to stop here and thank you very much for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you, ma'am. So I thank here all the esteemed speaker and it was very fruitful session. So now it's time for speaker memento. I would like to request my colleague Deepak. Can you please present speaker memento here? So now I would like to present speaker memento to Dr. A. Garg. Thanks for coming, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And this is speaker memento for Dr. Rajiv Kumar Upadhyay. Thanks for coming, sir. Dr. K. Maran, sir, this is for you. This is speaker memento. And thanks for coming. Professor S.S.V.N. Sharma, Director, Vagdevi College of Engineering, Warangal.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Professor Madhulika Kausik, Vice Chancellor, USA Martin University, Ranchi. Thank you, ma'am, for coming.
Thank you very much.
So with this, we are going to end this session, and we are wrapping third day of 18th World Education Summit 2021, 18th World Education Summit. So, namaste to all.